Hey, what up, guys? Good to see you again. We definitely miss being in person, but thankful that we can still get together and study the word, even if it's in a virtual format. So anyway, we are still in the book of Revelation tonight. This is our second teaching in Revelation 2 and 3, and we're looking through these letters that Jesus wrote, or he spoke through John directly to this group of churches in Asia Minor. A lot of the book of Revelation is truly about the future. But what we're reading here was written to the here and now, the people that were living during the time of John. And so today we're going to look at chapter 3, where he addresses three different churches that were in this large geographic area. But tonight we're really just going to talk about Philadelphia and Laodicea, two of those churches, and see what Jesus said to them means for us. Well, let's begin by looking at the church in Philadelphia. So when we think of Philadelphia, we think of obviously great mascots, right? Gritty, the Philly Fanatic, all these different images of the city that we know and love only 8 hours away from Columbus. Well, the ancient city of Philadelphia was very different in the sense that at this time in history, it was a really small place. There wasn't too much happening here. It was kind of a, it was a smaller town, it was a newer city, and therefore the church in the city was likely to be very new. And so here's what Jesus says to this church. He says, "This is the message from the one who is holy and true. What he opens, no one can close, and what he closes, no one can open." So he begins by saying that he is holy and true. When I was reading different commentaries on this passage, one of the commentators referred to Jesus as one who is real. So immediately that brought to mind the notion that Jesus is in fact a real one. In the words of Urban Dictionary, a real one is a friend that you can count on in all circumstances. And that is certainly true of Jesus Christ. It also says that he opens what no one can close, and he closes something that no one can open. What this means is that he's not just reliable, but he's also totally in control. We know that when we talk about doing the work of God or doing his ministry in the world, the only reason why any church or any person can do anything successfully that is supernatural is if God is blessing it. God opens doors for an impact on this world. He also closes them. And so when it comes to being effective for God, what matters more than anything else is that God is behind us and he is with what we are doing. And so that's what he's saying about himself. I'm the one who opens and closes doors. Don't get it twisted. He says, "I know all the things that you do, and I've opened a door for you that no one can close. You have little strength, yet you obeyed my word, and you did not deny me." All right, so here is the good news for this church. He says, "Sure, you guys have little strength." And that's true. They are probably a younger church. They're also probably a poorer church. The language that he uses suggested that they were not that influential in their society. They were not a wealthy group of people. They were suffering in certain ways. So he says, "Yeah, all of that stuff is true about you, but guess what? What really matters is that I am going to open up a door for you that no one can close. You might look at your resources and think, what can we possibly do?" But he says, "In my economy, in my world," he says, "you are going to do great things because you obeyed my word and you did not deny me." And it shouldn't surprise us that God works this way. We can turn to other passages in Scripture. We read 1 Corinthians 1 that says, "Not many of you were wise by human standards. Not many of you were influential or of noble birth. But God has chosen the foolish things of this world to shame the wise. And he's chosen the weak things of this world to shame the strong." The things the world rejects, the weak things, the foolish things, the things that seem like they're not that important or not that great, those are the very things that God can use. And so we should be careful never to count ourselves out or count our church out, your home church out, just because you feel like you're little, just because you feel like you're weak. In God's economy, that's not the thing that matters most. He says, "Look, I will force those who are persecuting you to come and bow down at your feet. They will acknowledge that you are the ones that I love." Did you notice something here? No bad news. He goes straight from the good news to an action step. There's nothing but encouragement for this church. These guys were freaking awesome. And the action step that he calls for, he's not even saying that they need to do something. He says, "Listen, I've got your guys' back, and I'm going to do it for you. Those guys who've been persecuting you, the ones who've been treating you this way," he says, "they're going to know that you're my people. I've got your back." He says, "Because you've obeyed my command to persevere, I'll protect you from a time of great testing. I am coming soon. Hold on to what you have so that no one will take away your crown." All who are victorious will become pillars in the temple of my God, and they will never have to leave it. And I'll write on them the name of my God, and they will be citizens in the city of my God. And so the thing that we can really learn from the church in Philadelphia is, once again, not to count ourselves out. We often measure what we think we can do based on our resources. We think about our money, we think about our energy, we think about our popularity, we think about what the surrounding culture thinks about us, and we say, well, you know, at least we can be faithful, at least we can do a few things. But we measure what God can do based off us. That's such a mistake. What matters most for any church or any person is whether or not God blesses what you do. And so the thing that we need to seek and depend on is the blessing of God, not just wealth or anything else like that. Well, that's a pretty good segue to talk about the next church, the church at Laodicea. We'll spend the rest of our time together just looking at them. Now, Laodicea was the opposite of Philadelphia, a well-established city, a center of commerce. This was considered to be the Wall Street of the region. It was a banking center. They were known for their production. They had incredible wealth. Now, one of the most incredible things about this particular letter to this church is that, unlike every other letter, there is no mention of persecution for this church. Oh my gosh, what were they doing right? I mean, can you imagine that? The surrounding culture had nothing bad to say about them. They were loved. People weren't offended by them in any way. Maybe we need some of that, right? Wouldn't it be nice to get absolutely no flack for your faith? Well, here's the thing. There's no persecution for this city, for the church in the city. But there's also no encouragement from Christ. That's right. Even though the surrounding culture was pleased with them, apparently God was not. Let's take a look at why that is. He says, this is the message from the one who is the Amen, the faithful and true witness, the beginning of God's new creation. It makes sense that Jesus would say this about himself to a church in a city that was very prosperous. He says, I'm the beginning of God's new creation. You see, only what God builds ultimately is going to last forever. People can build cities, they can build economies, they can build cultures, they can do all these things. But at the end of the day, God is making something new. What God is making is completely different from what this world makes for itself. And that's important for a prosperous group of people to remember. He says, I know all the things that you do, just like with every other church. And I know that you are neither hot nor cold. And I wish that you were one or the other. Yeah, hot and cold. Both of those things can be good in their own measure. Hot coffee, hot chocolate, that's the slam. That stuff's awesome. A cold glass of lemonade is just the best thing on a hot summer day. So both of these things can be positive. But to be lukewarm is at best just okay. You know, a lukewarm glass of water is whatever. A lukewarm old glass of milk is literally disgusting. And so what was it about this church that made them almost repulsive to Jesus? It's a pretty strong term. He says, since you are lukewarm, neither hot nor cold, he says, I will spit you out of my mouth. And so you can imagine just someone taking a drink of water, you know, finding out that's got, you know, maybe milk that's curdled and just spitting it out on the ground. Just the other day, I reached for a glass of water that was next to me. My daughters and I were watching The Mandalorian, and I reached for this glass of water and I took a drink of it. And what I didn't realize is that my kids had been crumbling up Cheez-Its. My daughter was like sucking on Cheez-Its and taking her Cheez-It like spit and putting it in my water. And so I just got this big, crusty, lukewarm Cheez-It concoction. And it was freaking disgusting. I almost spit the whole thing out onto her. And so that kind of reaction is what Jesus says he's going to have with the church in Laodicea. It's hard to imagine stronger terms. And so what does it mean to be lukewarm spiritually? Well, we can tell just from the language here that to be lukewarm, to not be hot nor neither cold, must mean to be comfortable, to be apathetic, to be unmotivated in a spiritual sense. And this is a distasteful, even repulsive way to be when it comes to spirituality. And so this would actually be a pretty good spot for people to stop and discuss. If you're with a small group, if you're, you know, meeting up with people on Zoom, pause the video for a moment and think about these two questions. What are some potential causes of spiritual apathy? And what could be some signs that we, as believers in God, are becoming these lukewarm kind of people? Let's think about that for a bit. Then once you're done, restart the video and join back up with us. All right, well, he goes on, and you'll notice that there's no good news for this church. He's straight to the bad news. And he says to them, "You say that I am rich, and I have everything that I want. I don't need a thing. But you don't realize that you are wretched, miserable, poor, blind, and naked." Whoa. So when we think about what the cause of spiritual apathy was for this specific church, and I believe that it could be a number of different things for different churches, but for this church, there was something about their apathy, there was something about their lack of motivation that had to do with the fact that they were materially prosperous, but spiritually, they were bankrupt. Spiritually, they were poor, blind, miserable, and naked. And it appears that they weren't really aware. That's one of the craziest things about it. They didn't know that they were in such a terrible spiritual state. Their self-perception was completely off. They ever met someone who just has a complete misperception of themselves? They have this grandiose idea of what they are or who they are. I was just thinking back on that Fyre Festival documentary that came out a couple years ago. That was a big deal. The whole thing was a sham. It tricked all these trust fund babies into pouring their money into this concert on this island that never happened. Well, if you watch the documentary, there's a part of it where Ja Rule gets up and he's talking to like this big crowd of people about how awesome the Fyre Festival is going to be. And he's talking about his own role in it. And he refers to himself as a rap mogul. And I remember in that moment just laughing out loud because Jay-Z is a rap mogul. P. Diddy is a rap mogul. Ja Rule is a washed up 90s rapper who plays trust fund babies' birthday parties, okay? He's not a rap mogul by any stretch of the imagination. And so it's that kind of thing. It's pathetic, actually, when someone sees themselves as one thing when in fact that's not the case at all. And so that's what was going on with this church. They were self-deceived. They were wealthy, and they thought that because they were successful by the world standards, that in some way made them successful in the eyes of God. But that just wasn't the case. And so the Bible has a lot to say about the dangers of stuff, the dangers of a life oriented around collecting and maintaining material things. There's a number of ways that living this way can really affect a person's spiritual life, and we often don't really realize that it's doing this to us until it's too late. Collecting and just being so focused on obtaining material things distracts us from what matters. It takes a long time. It takes mental bandwidth to scroll, to search, to buy, to sell, and then also to maintain the things that we have. And oftentimes, the more stuff that you have, the more that those things begin to own you. And so little bandwidth is left over for things like relating to God or investing deeply in spiritual community. It's also a fact that affluence, so to be materially successful, leads to pride. When you feel like you have a lot, and when you keep gaining more and more, there's this thing that happens where you start to feel entitled to that process. You feel like you deserve these things, and it's that very pride that begins to cause us to look down on other people, to think that we're better than people, and that we deserve something that other people, in fact, do not. A well-worn narrative in our culture is the idea that power corrupts people. You've got the Scarface, all these old movies that depict someone who starts from the bottom, where they're sincere, you know, they've got these great motives, they've got ambition, but then they get to the top and they just become this corrupted person. There's a truth about the way that human beings work as sinful people, that one of the major things that restrains us from being as selfish as we possibly could be is just opportunity. And so when someone has more power, when someone has more wealth, they have more opportunity to do and get whatever they want. And as we get more and more opportunity, we tend to abuse that opportunity, no matter who we are. And so wealth, especially the accumulation of wealth, can be corrupting to a person's soul. Then finally, the fact that consumer culture itself can just warp people's values over time. I was listening to this podcast the other day, and it talked about the ways that algorithms and social media, they don't just tell you about things that you like. They actually shape the way you think about the things that you buy. And so the algorithms aren't just designed to read you and then bring you the things that you're interested in. They're actually designed to teach you and to develop the things that you want into the things that they have to sell. And so what happens is, before long, we find ourselves thinking in ways, being motivated by things that really, in our natural selves, never should have been motivating. What we value, what we desire, what we chase after gets completely changed and becomes a far cry from what the things of God really are. And so this is destructive no matter who you are, but we're talking about the people of God, people who worship God, who want to follow God with the whole of our lives. There's real danger here. There's real danger. And if we're like the church in Laodicea, we don't even know that it happens to us before it's too late. And so there has to be a decision to really watch out for all of this. And so whenever we talk about something like this, it's easy to be like, okay, so what's the solution, Josh? Are we supposed to just drive out into Hocking Hills and live in Ash Cave together and not own anything or something like that? And the answer to that is no. The Bible never advocates for getting rid of all the things that we have. That's not a blanket prescription for people who want to be followers of Jesus. Instead, what we see is that the Bible gives the warning about how dangerous this can be, about the apathy and the distraction that it produces, but then it also gives us a constructive path forward. And so what we see in this very letter to the church in Laodicea is that Jesus gives them three concrete steps, three things that they can do to move out of this apathetic and lukewarm state that's been caused, by their materialism and pride. So in verse 18, he says, I advise you to buy gold from me, gold that has been purified by fire, and then you will be rich. So he says, you guys have gold. You guys have resources. Now you need to start converting that resource into something that's going to matter in the long run. If you've ever been to a place like Chuck E. Cheese's or Dave and Buster's, those places have their own currency that's only good within the establishment, right? So, you know, once you leave Chuck E. Cheese's, you can't take those tickets and go buy a cheeseburger across the street. You can't pay your rent with credit from Dave and Buster's. It's only good within the establishment. And so when you go to a place like that, what you really need to do is you need to accumulate a certain amount of it, but then you need to be thinking about how you're going to convert it into something that can be used once you leave. And this is a pretty fitting analogy, actually, for the way that things work in our world. The world and our universe is in many ways like a massive Chuck E. Cheese. We are accumulating coins and tickets. But at the end of the day, we need to be thinking about how we're going to convert all of this. Because, you know, we have to have this stuff to live in this environment. We have to be thinking about how we're going to convert it into something that's going to ultimately matter. And so in Luke 16, Jesus, after telling this story about a man, knowing that he didn't have that much time, took his resources and he used it to build relationships with people. He says, here's the lesson. Use your worldly resources to benefit others and make friends. Then when your possessions are gone, they will welcome you into an eternal home. And so we also need to find ways to take our resources and convert them into eternal things. To invest them in people, to invest them in the things of God, so that at the end of the day, we're not just going to be left standing with a bunch of worthless tickets and coins that mean nothing outside of the scope of the here and now. He then says, go and buy white garments from me so that you will not be shamed by your nakedness. So Laodicea was this center of textile production. They made all sorts of clothes. And he says, okay, that's cool. You guys are really into your image. You guys like to look good because you got access to all this awesome clothing. He says, but you should get real white garments. And white garments is an image that's used throughout the book of Revelation for righteousness, for being right in the sight of God. And he says, for me, so then you will not be shamed. In our culture, we are pretty image obsessed ourselves. We scroll through social media and we check out different influencers who tell us what to wear. And in a lot of ways, what we wear and how we present ourselves, how we cut our hair, are kind of viewed as the most important part of ourselves that we present on the outside. But in reality, the thing that matters the most to God is not our image. It's not what we project to other people. It's what's going on inside. And so Proverbs 51 says that God delights in truth in the inmost being. He said, and that's why the psalmist says, teach me the wisdom of the secret heart. And so God looks at the heart, while man looks at the outside appearance. And so if we want to escape the shame and the insecurity that comes from posturing and being obsessed with our images, we've got to start paying attention, not just to our closets, but to our hearts and the condition that they're in. And that's what God really wants to work on. And that's what's really going to last. And then finally, he says, buy ointment for your eyes so that you will be able to see. Once again, Laodicea was a place that produced these different kinds of ointments for medicinal purposes, like a salve that would go on people's eyes. Now, this was kind of like a homeopathic thing. This was not like real medicine that actually was like would be used by optometrists or something like this. And so Laodicea was full of Karens who were out there peddling their essential oils. Just slap some lavender on that. You'll be totally fine. It's going to be okay. And so this was a little bit of a luxury product that people would consume, but it was something that they depended on. Something they depended on to make themselves feel better. Once again, what Jesus is saying is that, like, listen, it's okay to take medicine to make yourself feel better. He says, but if you're relying on other things to ultimately heal you and to make you right, he says, man, you're looking at the wrong source. He says, in Jeremiah 17, the prophet calls out and says, oh Lord, if you heal me, I will be truly healed. If you save me, I will be truly saved. My praises are for you alone. And so what is our hope really in? When we feel bad, what do we look to feel good? Oftentimes, if you're coming from a Laodicean perspective, you're going to look at your next purchase. You're going to look at the clothes that you can buy, maybe some of the products that you can consume. But God's saying, listen, there's something that can come into you that's going to change you, that's going to heal you and bring you peace in a way that no medicine ever really could. And so I want you to take your innermost self to me. Well, what's amazing about this letter to Laodicea is despite how strong of language that Jesus uses, he still ends with a promise. Oh yeah, there's bad news for this church, and it's really bad, but he still ends with a promise. He says, I correct and discipline everyone that I love. So be diligent and turn from your indifference. It's all coming from love. God never confronts. Jesus never exposes sin to bring about shame. He exposes it out of love so that we might turn and be healed by him and learn that what he has for us is so much better than what we choose for ourselves. One of the really encouraging things about lukewarm water is that it can be heated up. You can heat up lukewarm water. It can get hot, scalding hot once again. And so when we talk about being lukewarm, this is not some fate that we're doomed to. If you're here listening to this tonight and you're like, I'm kind of apathetic spiritually. My mental bandwidth is taken up by scrolling through products far more than it is by, you know, I'm looking forward to what I can obtain, what I can buy way more than being connected to God. There's good news for you. There's good news for me because I find myself in this state as well. And that's that lukewarm water can be heated up until it is boiling hot once again. And there's a key to that. The key is that we need to let Jesus in so he can turn on the burners and bring us to that state. Revelation 3:20, one of the most famous verses in the entire Bible, a compelling image. Jesus says, look, I stand at the door and knock. And if you hear my voice and you open the door, I'll smack you in the face. No, it's not what he says. It says, I will come in. We will share a meal together as friends. So God wants a relationship. He even wanted a relationship with the people in Laodicea. Some of them might have been Christians. Some of them might not have been Christians. But in either case, he says, let me into your life. Let me in and I will heat you up. I will take you from a lukewarm state. I will show you what life is really meant to be about. I will give you a vibrant life. It's not just numb, floating from experience to experience and thing to thing, but something that is meaningful, something that just gets rid of, that takes the things in this life that you have and it converts them into things that will matter for all eternity. He says, that's the journey that I have for you. And it all begins with you just letting me into your life. So for most of us, this looks like just a prayer. where we reach out to God and say, it's like you turn the doorknob with your mind. You say, God, I want you to come in. Jesus, I want that relationship with you. Thank you that you love me. And you're telling me that I need this because you love me. And once we turn that knob and we welcome him into our hearts, it can be scary. When you don't know who it is that you're inviting in your house, it can be scary. But I encourage you to go back to chapter 1 of this book and to look at the vision of Jesus, this being of power, this being of power, but also love, who puts his hand on John and says, do not be afraid, for I am the first and the last. That's the being that you're letting into your heart when you make this decision. And I urge you not to wait a day more. Do it now. God will change you gradually. He will begin to show you who he is and then lead you along a path that will turn your life totally upside down. And it is so worth it. So I encourage you to do that now. Well, in conclusion, we should just think about these things practically. Are we turning our gold into real riches? We're about to enter the holidays. This is a period where a lot of people spend a lot of money. You're going to get a lot of stuff too. How are you going to take the things that you get and invest them in things that are eternal? Do you have ways to give to people who are in need? Do you have ways to support the work of God? If not with your money, then at least with your time. Take those opportunities. Are we paying more attention to the condition of our hearts or our closets? Again, I'm doing it myself. I recently did the whole Stitch Fix thing that people have been into. And it's so hard. You just keep thinking about all the different clothes, way to upgrade the things that you have. And it's okay to look good. It's all right. But is the condition of your heart being neglected? Why not take some time to really read the Bible, or maybe to read a really good spiritual book over the course of the holidays, something that dresses your innermost being and not just your body, and see what that does for your life. What are we relying on to make us feel better? These are also scary times. We turn to all sorts of things to make us feel better, but what are we relying on? What are we really trusting to make the difference? Let's put our trust in God. Let's take our eyes off some of the other things that we're just doing to kill the time, to get by, and let's put our eyes on God and see what he can do for us, because he's the one who made us. He knows what we need. And even though it's difficult sometimes, he will lead us into life lived the way that it was ultimately meant to be. And as we talked about, the first step is just to let him in. I'm just gonna pray right now to reach out to God, and I encourage you to pray with me if this is something that you know that you need. God, we know that you are bigger than us. You are far different than us. You created all things. And it can be scary to think about the fact that only what you build will last. You really are the first and the last. And that everything that we depend on in this life is temporary. It can be knocked over. It can be taken away. But God, I thank you that you don't just leave us in that insecure state, but you're offering yourself to us. You want to forgive our sin. You want to accept us, God, as your children. And all that you ask from us is that we have the humility to open up the door and say, you know what? I'm not content in here with just my wealth. I'm not just content in here with myself. I want you to be in here too, God. And I pray for anyone who's never made that decision that they would listen and in this moment reach out and ask you for that very thing. Amen.